We've been looking at what happens with when viruses encounter an environment or have been in an environment and continue in that one environment. So basically, we're assuming that these poor little suckers have a really boring life. They find nothing but whatever it is that we give them, and that's all they know ever. But in reality, that's not what happens. In reality, viruses have to encounter changes in the environment all the time, some more than others. Some viruses have very narrow host ranges, meaning the variety of things that they can infect. Some are narrow even within a host. There are viruses such as hepatitis C that pretty much can do absolutely nothing anywhere except in hepatocytes of humans. And even in the hepatocytes of humans, if you try to grow them in the flask, that is enough of a change so they can no longer do the job. You have to cheat and do all sorts of things to encourage them, okay? Other viruses have single species as hosts, but then they can infect a variety of cell types. And you can have different anatomical sites where you can imagine that environmental conditions, as far as the virus goes, may change, may vary, and then you can have local adaptation. Sometimes you see differences between anatomical sites, but those are not due to adaptation, they are due to bottlenecking. So depending on who makes it to a different spot, then you can see a different population with a different set of mutations get fixed. Going up, then you have viruses that have a fairly good number of choices within a relatively small group of hosts, maybe the species or maybe the genus. And then you have things like some of the plant viruses, which I think are the most extreme, where you have viruses that can infect plants and are transmitted by insects, and they actually can also replicate in insects. So you have basically something that can work in a plant and can work in an animal. Almost as good, just a tiny, tiny, tiny little bit less good, are what are called the arboviruses. Arthropod born viruses. So these are viruses that cycle between a vector that is typically an arthropod and a host that is typically a vertebrate. And needless to say, the ones that we worry the most about is those where the vertebrate is us, okay? The other reason why looking at arboviral evolution and how they handle different environments is interesting is because you can use this type of natural setup to think about things like radiation, like speciation. How do I get to differentiate two populations enough that now they can make two new species? Versus how can I keep a virus that is able or a microorganism or an organism that is capable of doing okay in multiple environments? And that in turn turns down to what the cost of specialization and the cost of generalization is. So these are very basic concepts in ecology and evolution. Speciation, generalization, specialization that you can address looking at the biology and the evolutionary traits that you see changing in arboviral populations. So the cycles that arbovirus go through okay, so you're asking why is a virus virulent in one host and not in other? Okay, so what makes a virus infect two different hosts? The fact that they can interact with the cellular machinery that they need coming from different hosts, meaning that if you have a virus that has a receptor that is widespread throughout all the animal kingdom, then provided that everything else is the same, you can then infect all those cells that have that particular receptor. Receptors are one of the most common ways of restricting viral tropism. So not always, but very often, if you have the receptor, you can infect the cell. If you do not have the receptor, you cannot infect the cell, okay? But it's just one of the multiple host proteins or host components that interact with, that have to interact with the virus in order for the complete cycle to take place. Once the virus makes it in, there's going to be a number of other host proteins that are also needed. And again, if you have host proteins that can do the job, you'll get replication, otherwise you don't. Yeah. No, it's not just the receptor. The receptor is one example of how you can either infect two cell types or infect one but not the other. So if the two cell types have the same receptor, both should be susceptible, everything has been equal. If one cell has the receptor but the other doesn't, this will be susceptible, this will not. Okay? But again, with the case of arboviruses, although I'm not gonna ruin my lecture, so I'm not gonna tell you the bottom line, okay? All right, so the simplest of the cycles that you can imagine for an arbovirus is that you have a vector, and the vectors that I will be talking about are largely mosquitoes. Of which you know all about here. Sandflies are very similar to mosquitoes, but instead of punching to get your blood meal, they bite. And then ticks. Okay, many of the encephalitis viruses go through ticks. And then let's start with an infected vector. Oh yeah, flea-borne viruses. I don't know. I'm not gonna. I don't know. Which one? Polio? Which one? Okay. All right. So we still have an infected vector that comes flying into a vertebrate host. Okay. And again, here, hosts are plentiful. And many of the arboviruses have multiple hosts, but among the most popular, us, primates or non-human primates, birds are very popular. Okay, so when the virus makes it into the vertebrate host, it starts replicating. It makes lots of virus. These viruses typically end up in blood. So when you have virus in blood, you call that viremia. And if the virus does a good enough job, so viremia is high, you have a high concentration of virus, another vector is gonna come and pick it up. Okay, so you have cycling between the vector and the host. The vector gets infected. The host gets infected, the vector gets infected, the host gets infected. This is the simplest of the cycles, but over on that simple cycle, you can actually start looking at more complicated types of dynamics. For instance, you can have cycles in different ecological areas. In the case of dengue virus, you have the Sylvan cycle, and you have the urban cycle. And the hosts are essentially, or can be, the same as a group, but the difference between the two cycles is that the Sylvan cycle in dengue is primates, it's monkeys usually that keep the cycle going. The urban cycle in dengue is humans that keep the cycle going. So what happens is that this vector, if it's a Sylvan vector, it's a vector that is in the forest, and a human comes in, into the forest and gets bitten, when the human comes back to the town, it brings the virus with it, and then either the same vector or sometimes a different vector can start the urban cycle. So things, again, get a little bit complicated. And regardless of whether you have one or two or whatever number of cycles in your natural life, the thing that happens all the time with arboviruses is that sometimes you bite the wrong vertebrate. A blood meal is a blood meal. If it comes for free, who cares? So what happens is that sometimes the vector will go to humans or farm animals and many other things, but again, because we normally pay attention to the things that bother us, those are the two that we worry the most about. And what happens in this case is that the virus makes it in, it starts the infection, it makes more virus, but the level of viremia, the amount of virus per milliliter in blood, is not enough for the next vector to come and recover the virus. So if you can imagine that in a host, in this part of the graph, you need to make 10 to the 10 PFUs per milliliter. And then a mosquito comes and takes a blood meal, and it's just a few microliters. So you have whatever number, 100, 1,000, 10,000 PFUs. If you can only make a fraction of that titer, yes. Oh, yes. Okay, the vector is affected. If you really try to look for changes in the vector, you will see them. But you have to really, really, really try. Okay? No, it doesn't die. Yeah. Okay, so again, if this host cannot make enough viremia to statistically give a chance for the mosquito to pick up something when it takes its blood meal, what happens is that as far as the virus goes, it's in an ecological trap, okay? So we call this host natural hosts, and we call these hosts dead end hosts. So we worry about the dead end host because we don't want to get sick, we don't want our cows to get sick and our horses to get sick. But as far as the virus goes, they don't care. It doesn't make any difference to them. All right? Now, yes. Yes, okay. Yes, but it's more complicated. Okay, so going back to your question, what's the difference between the infections that we see in the host and in the vectors? Huge, okay? In the case of infected vectors, as I was saying, you really have to look for effects. If you look very, very carefully, you see a little bit of a fitness effect on the vector. So you may have sometimes fewer eggs, not many, but a little bit. If you really, again, if you do enough numbers, you can actually hit statistical significance. You may have a little tiny bit of an average earlier average age of death that gets a little bit skewed up, so it's a little bit earlier. But if you have an infected mosquito or an infected sandfly, and you compare it with an uninfected mosquito or an uninfected sandfly, you cannot tell. They're happy, they fly around, which makes sense, because if the virus was causing high virulence in these vectors, then they would not be able to move around and go and bite the next host to transmit the virus. So here we hook up with the evolution of virulence that we talked about in the second class, something. In the vector, okay, the concentration in the vector is actually lower than the concentration in the host, but the virus is actually actively taken to the salivary glands, so you don't have to worry about sampling effects because the virus is going to go into the saliva that we get when they bite us. And actually the saliva of these mosquitoes and of these sandflies have components that improve the odds of transmission. It's weird. Yes. I know that this is not viruses, I know that, but I know the malaria parasite makes the mosquitoes to go for hot and CO2. I'm not sure about viruses. I know that other viruses do change the behavior of the host, rabies virus, it makes you bite to get transmitted. But I don't know that there is evidence that arboviruses change the behavior of the vectors. More? More questions? Yes. Where the virus provides advantages to the vectors, not that I know of. There is only one really weird and nice example that I told some of you that I know of about the virus providing advantage, like a clear advantage to somebody. I mean, usually these viruses kind of are either commensals, meaning that they don't really do much to us, or they are pathogens, meaning that they kind of do stuff to us. But there's this example of a virus that infects a fungus that lives in hot springs, and this fungus infects a plant that lives in these hot springs. And the plant that has been infected with the fungus, that has been infected with the virus, is resistant to heat, so it can live there. But if you take off the fungus, the plant dies. If you put the fungus, but the fungus is not infected with the virus, the plant dies. You need the three partners to keep everybody alive. It's kind of super cool. It's a science paper that is absolutely beautiful. Okay, so we go back to our more questions. We go back to our arboviruses, and I forget who made a very good point that the way that infection occurs in the vector and the way that infection occurs in the host is very, very different. Okay? Again, vectors typically pick up the virus, get infected for life. So basically they carry the virus until they die. And while again, in some cases, some people have been able to measure a bit of a fitness effect on the vector, for all practical matters, they are perfectly happy. If you have in cell culture cells from these vectors and you let them get infected with virus, you cannot tell which flask has the virus and which flask doesn't. Okay? In contrast, if you go to the host, whether they are natural or dead end doesn't seem to matter, the virus comes in, tends to make a big mess, sometimes more than others, and then gets high viremia, lots of killing, lots of pathogenesis, lots of virulence, pathogenesis, maybe sometimes higher, maybe sometimes lower, meaning that sometimes you can do the job with fewer, or with a smaller inoculum, sometimes you need a lot to actually get something going on. But the point is that usually those are infections where you can very clearly see an effect in the cells and cell killing. Two more comments regarding these cycles. One, humans are natural hosts for dengue fever, for yellow fever, and that's pretty much about it. All right? For all the other horrible arboviruses that are going around, humans are dead end hosts. Okay, so we play for most part to a large extent no role whatsoever in the evolution of these arboviruses. The other thing is that these vectors that get infected, not only they get infected for life, but they can actually transmit the virus to their progeny. So the females, who are the ones who take the blood meals and get infected, transmit the virus to the eggs, and then the eggs hatch as infected vectors. So what you have here is transmission vector host vector, and vector to itself. And once again, the type, yes. Arthropod borne virus. So meaning it's a virus that is transmitted by an arthropod. And again, the arthropods can be any of these things. Most of the arboviruses, all of, I'm not going to say all because I might be lying, but most of the arboviruses are RNA. That's a very good question. So if the virus is so happy in the vector, why bother go to the host? And the reason is that usually this transmission vector to progeny is relatively inefficient. So you can keep it for 5 generations, 6 generations, but eventually you lose it. Okay? So you need a step of mammalian or vertebrate replication to amplify the virus and keep the cycle going. Okay? Well, if you have to remember that a mosquito is this size and a vertebrate is this size. So even if you don't change the concentration, the amount of virus that, that you're talking about is many, many orders of magnitude bigger when you get in the mammal. Plus, not only you do that, but then you can infect multiple vectors out of a single mammal. Okay, so this is called vertical. If you go from one bug to one animal, or the other way around, or one animal to another animal, you call that a horizontal transmission. When you go from mother to progeny, that's vertical transmission. And what happens is that these mosquitoes and these sandflies, the females, when they get infected, their eggs get infected. So when the progeny hatches, it's already infected. But again, the problem is that this is a relatively inefficient mode of transmission. So maybe, I'm making this up, I don't remember the numbers, only 80% of the progeny is infected, or only 60% of the progeny is infected. So if you keep the system going down the line in 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 generations, basically there's no infected eggs anymore. Nobody knows. Nobody knows. No. But, yes. No, it's the same viral particle that comes into the sandfly as what you get when you come into the mammal, and it's the same type of virus particle that comes out of the sandfly or the mosquito that comes out of the mammal. It's exactly the same thing. I have the theory that there's evidence of the other, or things that, that are the other way around. Okay, I'm going to ruin the rest of my lecture. My theory is that some of these viruses are actually insect viruses that have found a way of improving their odds by picking up a vertebrate host to blow up that numbers. That's my theory, okay? And there's a little bit of evidence of that, and I will tell you what. I will tell you what it is. All right. Okay, so we have the infection of the vector, because this is a type of infection where you have the virus coming in. If you were to do in the cells a growth curve, the way that this growth curve looks like is that you start with virus that you pump, that you dump into your cells, and the first thing, of course, the virus goes in, disappears, comes out to relatively high titer. Things sort of stabilize, kind of. And if you just keep going, you turn down the replication, but you don't turn it off. So there's continuous production of low-level virus that lasts for the life of the cells. And you have to kill the cells to stop the virus, okay? So even if you consider a sandfly, you can call that, even though there's no cell killing, the acute phase. And what happens here is the persistent phase. Okay, this is in contrast of what you see that we have already talked about in the mammal, where the virus goes out, and unless you provide new cells, eventually all the virus will die. Okay, sometimes there are viruses that are very stable outside, so this can take a long, long time, but again, if you don't provide cells, you can wait until the virus dies. Okay, so this is all basically an acute infection. There's no persistent phase, right? Okay, so that's the basic setup that we're going to be looking at. Okay, so because of this alternation between what we think of as very disparate vectors and hosts, one can use these viruses to look at the cost of specialization and the cost of generalization. And the idea here is that one can imagine that the environment that the vector provides has to be very, very different than the environment that a host provides, okay? And if you think about it in terms of fitness landscapes, and again, this is something that I don't know if it's true. I cannot predict the fitness landscapes. I will have to do the experiments first. But you can imagine that if you have something like this in the mammalian environment, when you switch to the insect environment, you may have something like this. Okay, a very, very different landscape. In this particular case, I only have one area where the peaks are tiny, but at least they go both up, and that basically corresponds to a spot where if I have a virus here, at the top of the fitness peak, it's going to do fairly nicely in both environments. It's not great, it doesn't suck. Okay, it's okay, but it's okay in both environments, okay? And if you look at the studies that have been done in terms of arboviral evolution in nature, which are basically limited to sequence studies, just looking at how fast and how slowly these viruses evolve, what happens is that compared to other RNA viruses, arboviruses tend to evolve relatively slowly. Compared to the DNA world, they're still shooting up like crazy, but you're talking about rates of 10^-4, 10^-5 substitutions per nucleotide and year. If you think about things like, again, flu, you're talking about 10^-3. So this looks like a reasonably good explanation to explain why these arboviruses fall slowly. Because if you are in the mammal, if you're in the mammal here, okay, and let's say that for whatever reasons, let's say that you have a born leg and you come down here, you remember that you need to stop selection to take anybody down the fitness peak, but let's say that your born leg put your population here, now this guy can go up this peak. But if this guy comes at this peak, when it goes back to the sandfly, we have a valley here. And that means that in the sandfly, this guy is going to do poorly, or in the mosquito. And long term, it's going to get cleaned up. All right? So the idea here is that because of the lack of overlapping fitness peaks, any virus that is selected as a specialist, meaning doing well in one environment, specialist is going to have to pay a price, so when the environment changes, its fitness is going to go down. Compared to the generalist that is not going to do great in either of the two environments, but it's going to do okay in both, and therefore it can survive. So So basically, the whole concept is that the reason why these viruses are, or the model that you think of when you think about these viruses is that these are master generalists, where they can go around the place, they don't do great anywhere, but they're okay pretty much everywhere. Yes. Okay, so Deepa is making a very good point, and what she's basically saying is that this works only if we keep selection up. The moment we relax selection, if we allow bottleneck effects, then all odds are off, because then you can have low fitness mutants in either environment survive simply because there's no one else to compete with. Okay, this is probably true for some of the viruses, but at least for others, to me that was actually quite a bit of a surprise. The amount of virus that the suckers get in a blood meal is 10^5, 10^4, and the amount of virus that they put back in the infected host is also a very large population. So we know that at least for some of these viruses, you can actually keep very, very high population sizes. Therefore, you can avoid, for the most part, some of these bottleneck events. One per genome. They are. Yep. Remember that every time you have a cell infected, you're going to generate your one per genome. Okay. All right. So. This sounds reasonable, doesn't it? Anybody has any criticism? Comments? Okay, let's go and test it. Okay, so let's take a virus. And of course, my favorite virus, as you all know, is VSV. And let's take some sandfly cells. And let's put VSV in sandfly cells and follow fitness changes. It's a little bit dirtier than when we see in BHK cells, but the difference between the changes in fitness in sandflies and the changes in fitness in BHK cells is orders of magnitude. Here we're talking about improvements in fitness in the hundreds to thousands. It's insane, it's ridiculous. Okay, and then it kind of sort of goes all over the place. All right? So if our prediction is correct, that the problem with this or the stability of these viruses come from being incapable of specializing and then without paying a price, what you would expect is that if we test fitness of the sandfly-adapted virus in BHK cells, it will go down. Right? Okay, so let's do some competitions. I mentioned that when we do competitions, we use different initial ratios to make sure that we don't have to worry about frequency-dependent selection. But if we have an expectation that one of the two viruses is going to do a lot better or a lot worse than the other, we skew the ratios a little bit so the loser has a chance to show up in the plaque assay. So we did that, and then when we looked at the relative ratio of test virus and reference virus, we only saw one population. Okay, something must have happened. Maybe the antibody is not working. Maybe the cells are feeling funky. Maybe, who knows? Let's do it again. Same thing happened. We couldn't see the reference virus. Sandfly adapted virus in BHK cells, its fitness goes up. Not only it goes up, but if you compare the fitness of the BHK-adapted virus with the fitness of the sandfly-adapted virus in BHK cells, they pretty much look the same. Okay, in the case of the sandfly-adapted viruses, it's more noisy, so it's a less nice, less perfect correlation, but basically it's the same story. Okay, so fitness increase in sandflies, concomitant fitness increase in BHK cells. So now what happens when we look at the virus that has been adapted to BHK cells? And again, this is more noisy than when I draw in here, but it doesn't do as well as the sandfly-adapted virus, but it also goes up. Okay? So this, yes. That's the second part of the talk, okay? Okay, so to make a long story short, people did the same type of experiments in cell culture with dengue virus and with Eastern equine encephalitis virus and with St. Louis encephalitis virus and with West Nile encephalitis virus and with tick-borne encephalitis virus, lots of encephalitis viruses. And there's a bunch of papers now. And there are two typical outcomes. One is that everything gets better everywhere, or sometimes you do have a situation where in one environment goes up, in the other environment will go down. So in some cases you do see trade-offs. All right? Okay, but now what matters at the end of the day is not what happens in these single cell types, because that's not what really happens in life. In life, you keep going back and forth. So does this mean that when you have the virus cycling, it will remain stable because it has to deal with these two? If I get better here, I'm going to get worse there? And to make a long story short, the answer is no. So if you have the virus that has been going back and forth, everything gets better everywhere. Even when in individual cell types, you do see trade-off. Okay? So what seems to be happening is that when the viruses encounter a single cell, they find a preferred solution. But when they encounter these back and forth environments, they find alternative solutions that work in both environments. So if you have only one of them, you have a preferred way to do that. But if you have to go back and forth between both, then you can go with second best option and deal with both environments. Okay? And there is some work done with dengue. Let me make sure that I don't miss anything before I keep going. Okay, so again, this ability of finding very good solutions to multiple problems means that the cost of generalization in these viruses is very, very little. They don't have to get stuck in one of these little peaks. You can actually imagine landscapes where instead of having a small peak here, you have a big peak here. So the overlapping in this fitness peak is much more common and leads to much better or much higher levels of fitness than what people initially imagined. And the explanation for stability in this particular case to me is you're at the top of a fitness peak. You cannot get much better. You're so good already that there's very, very little room for improvement. And that's why evolution is slowly. There are no data in nature because those are difficult things to look at. But in cell lines, that comes next. Okay, so I'm gonna the long and short answer is that it depends. Okay, so how does dengue manage to deal with situations like this where you see fairly dramatic trade-offs, and when you do the alternation, you actually are fairly happy in both environments? We know how dengue does it. Okay, so the genome of dengue is positive stranded, is fairly similar to that of poliovirus. The main difference is that instead of polio having the capsid here and the enzymes here, dengue has the same. It's the same story. So it has secondary structures here, and it has secondary structures here, okay? And you need these secondary structures to replicate. Okay, so this is our 3', and this structure is the one that adapts to either mammals or mosquitoes. So if you mess with this, if you mess with this structure, you either end up with a mammalian adapted virus that does poorly in mosquitoes, or with a mosquito adapted virus that does poorly in the mammals. Okay? So what does the virus do when we take it back and forth? Ta-da! And now I can devote this one to one cell type and devote this one to the other cell type. There we go. Okay. There is one more situation which is what happens when instead of having passages in which we take the virus out of the acute phase of the of infection of the vector, we start looking at what happens during the persistent phase, which is what, after all, happens in nature. That's what happens in real life. Okay? If we, instead of going back and forth between the mosquito cells or the sandfly cells and the mammalian cells, taking virus out at the when it's making the most, we wait and we take the virus out when it has become persistent, then the dynamics of fitness changes is completely different. The persistence adapted virus goes up like crazy in fitness in the sandfly environment. It's seriously screwed in the mammalian environment. But then it gets even more weird because if you keep going, actually this here things get a little bit better. Okay? If you look at the virus that is has been going back and forth, it looks exactly the same as the virus that has been doing only persistence. So this is the persistent virus and the alternating virus, and this is the mammalian virus. And this is in the sandfly environment. If you look at what happens with the mammalian adapted virus, you have already seen that mammalian in mammalian goes up, mammalian in sandfly goes up, and the alternating virus goes up, so everybody goes up. So here we have two situations, one in which the trade-offs still don't result in stability, in stasis, in fitness. The alternative virus behaves exactly the same as the persistent virus. Looks like it doesn't matter whether you have a mammalian step or not. Okay, and the other thing that you can see from those type of results, and again, this is something that we have seen with other viruses such as West Nile, is that the cause, when there are causes, may be asymmetrical. So it may be that adapting to one environment will give you a bad virus for another environment, but if you switch who goes first, you cannot predict the outcome. So if I have a virus that is adapted to the mammals, and I know that this virus does better in the sandflies, and now I have a virus that is adapted to sandflies, I cannot predict how is it going to make in the mammalian cells. Yes. Okay, so if you take the mammalian adapted virus and you test fitness in the sandfly cells, or if you take the sandfly adapted virus and you test fitness in the mammalian cells. So in this particular case, did this correctly? No, this is, sorry, yep. So this is the mammalian environment. This is the sandfly environment. And again, in the case of West Nile, instead of having the VH case, they use bird cells, because West Nile infects birds. And instead of using sandfly cells, they use mosquito cells. But it's basically the same idea, that you have sometimes trade-offs in one direction, but not in the other direction. It's the sandfly. So insects do have some immunity and some anti-stuff molecules, but it's not antibodies. Okay? Probably, but then the other thing that you have to remember is that here you have continuous viral production, okay? And when you have continuous viral production, means that any cell in your flask, whether it's infected or not already, has a chance of getting reinfected. So what happens with MOI under those conditions? Is it high or is it low? It can, yeah, so if you have a cell that has been that is in the persistent phase, the cells are happy there. The way you passage the virus is actually not taking the virus out and put it into new cells. What you do is what happens with the mosquitoes and with the sandflies, which you carry the cells and you split the cells, and these cells keep making virus. Okay, but again, regardless of whether you are infected or not, there's going to be tons of virus in the medium, so you can get reinfected. Multiplicity of infection goes up, goes down. It goes up because now you have the same number of cells, but you keep getting more and more virus, okay? What happens with complementation when MOI goes up? It goes up as well. What happens with selection? It goes down, okay? And that means that during this persistent phase, one thing that is particularly kind of interesting and cool is that because you have such high levels of complementation, then you can keep all sorts of goodies, even though remember that when we do fitness assays for the whole population. And when we do sequencing, we sequence the consensus sequence of the population. So we may have, and actually we do have, genomes in the population that are harboring mutations that are not the best or may not even be good for the persistent environment. But when you take those things and you move them to another environment, then you can have very fast adaptation. Okay? And if you keep the thing back and forth, there's a good chance that you don't see this effect and the alternating virus behaves as the persistent virus simply because of numbers. In a single passage, even if you have something that is absolutely fabulous at a 10 to the minus 4 concentration, let's say that your fitness is 10. So if you have 10,000 particles and you start with one, the next day you have 10 particles out of 10,000. You're never going to see that in a sequencing machine. And whatever effect you can have in fitness in the short period of time like that is going to be relatively minimal. But if you take that virus out of the alternation and you keep it in a mammalian environment, then you can see these suckers come up and take care of increasing fitness. Okay? But this is in some viral systems. It's not true for all viral systems. These similar experiments were done with chikungunya virus, and the fitness results are similar, but the sequencing results are a little bit different, and in this particular case, it's actually kind of like the opposite. So what Marco Vignucci noticed with chikungunya is that, unlike VSV, that increases in diversity during alternation, chikungunya decreases in diversity during alternation. And I cannot really make a lot of sense out of it, but the data is the data, and he did experiments correctly. So, because I could imagine that everything would have behaved the same way like here. So when you have this type of alternation, you just keep the minority genomes in the population. Now, what did come as a surprise is that not as much, but if you look at the persistent virus that has been persistent for, I don't want to tell a lie, but I think we kept it for 10 months. If you look at the population and if you put now that population back in the mammal, you can actually see sometimes these minority mutants going to getting fixed in the mammalian environment. So even though the alternation helps, even though the mammalian phase may help with the maintenance of these minority mutants, if you eliminate the mammalian step, you still have them there. And again, you can keep them in the persistent phase, at least for the period that we looked at, through complementation. And that was actually a very weird, we were really, really puzzled, because if you look at the sequences of these viruses, I'm making this up. So you get these mutations in the persistence adapted virus, and you take this out of the persistence, you put it in the BHK cells for 10 passages. 10 passages is like nothing, okay? And then you look at the mutations. And you don't see any of these mutations, and you see a completely different batch of them. And we could not understand how that was possible. Because again, if you keep the environment constant, we have trouble getting a single mutation fixed in 20 passages. And this is what you see in 10 passages. So what we did is clonal analysis of the persistent populations and the alternating populations. And what we did is we did plaque assays. And then we looked for plaques of different sizes. And this is something that is, we did not do random picking, which is what we normally do with Miller-Schwarzschild experiments. Instead of picking random plaques, what we went for was, let's look for big plaques. Let's see if we can find any big plaques. And now let's look for tiny, 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 pitiful plaques. Okay? And then we got a couple of big plaques, and we got a couple of little plaques. And what happened is that, of course, the little plaques were the vast majority of the plaques that we found in the plate. The vast majority of the little plaques had the persistent mutations. The couple of big plaques that we found had the signatures of the mammalian adapted virus. And then if you do fitness, again, these guys are okay-ish in the sandflies, but a lot worse than these guys. But because you have complementation, even though they are in worse shape, they perform worse, you can keep them for very, very long periods of time. the question that we never answered, and it's a good question, is there any story regarding defective interfering particles here? Do we have any defective interfering particles in these culture conditions? And the answer is probably. And the reason why I think that that is the case is because in the persistence adapted virus, in the alternating virus as well, we repeatedly found a large, for a virus, insertion and mutations in the termini, including insertions and mutations in the polymerase, of which we also found a bunch, are typical signatures of escape from DIPs. If you remember from the first day we talked about DIPs, and I only tell you the beginning of the story. So what happens is that you start with a helper virus and a DIP. Let's say that it looks like this, okay? So again, because of its size, right? And some of the mutations are going to hit the promoters. And some of the mutations are going to hit the polymerase. And if you have the right mutations in the polymerase and in the promoter, then what you can do is a new polymerase that can no longer recognize the wild-type termini. So now this new polymerase can recognize the new promoters, but not the old promoters. Therefore, whatever polymerase you make is going to replicate the full virus, is not going to replicate the DIPs. So what happens with the relative frequency of the two of them? It changes to increase here, decrease here. And then if you keep the MOI constant, you can generate yellow DIPs. And if this guy keeps replicating, you can generate orange wild-type mutant. So you keep, this is another example of Red Queen dynamics. With the wild-type keeps generating DIPs that keep overcoming the wild-type, which keeps escaping the DIPs, but generates a new batch of DIPs, which keep inhibiting the wild-type until it escapes. And you have these cycles of things going on. And again, it's very typical to see things happening in the termini. And moreover, it's relatively frequent to see insertions in the termini, which is what we see in the sandfly adapted or in the alternating viruses, big insertions in the termini. Okay. Any questions? Okay, then one more comment. Remind you that the changes in fitness in either or both host and vector may or may not correlate with changes in virulence. The vector, as far as we can tell, the virulence is basically pretty much none. Okay, in the host, the virus can be virulent or not. It's more common to find high virulence in the dead-end hosts than in the natural hosts. And for some of these viruses, the way that disease progresses follows what people in public health call the pyramid. So the majority of the infected individuals are at the base of the pyramid and suffer absolutely no effect whatsoever. Yes. Virulence. Virulence is the extent of the disease caused by a pathogen. Okay, so high virulence, lots of damage. Low virulence, not a lot of damage. Pathogenesis is the ability to cause disease. So high pathogenesis, you need very few PFUs or very few bacterial cells or very few parasites to do something. Low pathogenesis, you need to load the host to do something. Okay? All right. So pretty much nothing at the base of the pyramid. Some animals, some people, some hosts will show relatively mild disease. In our case, maybe a little bit of fever, maybe, you know, you don't feel too well. If you keep going, things start getting kind of ugly. If you have dengue, then you have, as you probably all know, bone break disease, so it's not particularly pleasant, as far as I was told. And then if you keep going, you start with the more severe cases of dengue infection, where you have a hemorrhagic fever, and then at the top of the pyramid, you have dengue shock syndrome, of which you can very easily die. The changes in these sandfly-adapted viruses, if you follow the how they behave in the BHK cells, this was, okay, here. So if you look at the virulence that these different viruses have in the mammalian environment, in the mammalian cells, it doesn't change in the vector cells, it doesn't change in the sandfly cells. But in the mammalian, this loses virulence. And you say, okay, fine, I'm going down in fitness, I'm going down in virulence, that makes sense. But if you look at subsequent time points, when fitness becomes to be recovered, virulence keeps going down. So the least virulent of the populations is here at the end of the experiment. Okay? And these are viruses that have a really hard time making changes in the cell that you can recognize in the microscope. Okay, so here again, an example where you can dissociate fitness and virulence. Sometimes they go together, sometimes they don't. Okay. As I said, it looks like these type of changes in the promoter are at least in part responsible for what happens during adaptation to persistent infection. It's not the first time that you see adaptation mediated by promoter sequences, and I hope and I think it's probably not going to be the last. If you have received the polio vaccine here, chances are that you have received the live polio vaccine, the one that you get a droplet in a sugar cube, and then you eat the sugar cube. This is a vaccine that has been attenuated because of changes in the iris. If you remember, that's the element in the 5', which is where the promoter is. And that's the structure that you have of the 5' of the poliovirus genome that helps the virus recognize the ribosome and do translation when it's chopping all the eukaryotic factors that normally the cell uses to do translation. Okay, so there are like 20 or 30 mutations in the poliovirus vaccine, but of all of those, one here, and just another loop here, and one here, those are the three main mutations that attenuate the virus. And the way that this virus was generated is using cell culture. So when the virus adapted to these new conditions, there were a trade-off for replication in the human gut, okay? And this trade-off is mediated by these three mutations. So here we have another situation where specialization, adaptation for one particular environment, the cost of adaptation to a second environment is the result of changes in the promoter region. And again, if you want to think about the dengue example that I was telling you about, this is not quite the promoter, but it is in an untranslated region. So it's not just the proteins that the virus has to change to adapt to one, like the receptor, which again, it's important, but it's not the only thing that determines whether the virus is going to be capable of replicating in one or in multiple environments. All right?
Okay. All right. So what happens in vivo? The experiments that have been done in vivo are a fairly good reflection of the results that we have gotten in vitro. And this is something that makes me fairly happy because it gives some meaning to the use of relatively simple conditions in the laboratory to try to understand processes. And you can have, once again, this type of situation where everything gets better everywhere, or at least you do not have cost, you have no changes in fitness, or you can have a situation like this where you can see in vectors and hosts adaptation that involve cost in the other environment. But except for one, no, except for two cases, whenever you have alternation in vivo, you have improvement in both vector and hosts. So this is a very good correlate with what we saw in vivo. The examples where this is not true resemble a little bit this situation where you have one of the environments making the driving the evolution of the virus, and the other environment doesn't matter. So if you have chikungunya virus, I think it's chikungunya. No, it's not chikungunya. I don't remember which one. One of the arboviruses, now I'm I'll look it up later. So for one of the arboviruses, it's the mosquitoes that are determining the evolutionary pace. So if you look at the evolution of the two in the two environments, what happens in the mammal doesn't really matter. The virus that has been replicated in the mosquitoes behaves exactly the same as the virus that has been replicating back and forth, and different than the virus that has been replicating in the, I think they use mice or something, or guinea pigs or something like that. Okay? Which is basically what happens exactly here, where based on fitness changes and based on sequence changes, it looks like the role of the mammal is absolutely minimal. And in the case of BSV, there has been some studies done in terms of transmission. And one of the things that we have learned is that you don't need sometimes replication of the virus in the mammal to get transmission. So what happens is that there are some insects that behaviorally they all go to the same spot in the animal that they are biting, so like black flies. So if a black fly comes in infected, it deposits the virus in the animal, and because everybody else is there, there is a very good chance that other black flies bite the same area and pick the virus up. You don't have to have viremia. You don't have to have replication. And again, this is not true for all the viruses, and for many, you do need viremia. But in some cases, and again, this is borne by the results that we have gotten in cell culture, it looks like the only role for the mammalian is to be capable of overcome this limitation that vertical transmission has in terms of being inefficient and needing at some point some amplification or some way to pass the virus to other vectors. Does it make sense? All right, questions? Okay, I know I'm early, but I'm early because I wanted to talk for a couple of minutes about the papers that you got for the open session. I thought of sending questions to you, but instead of sending questions, what I'm going to do is point you towards the spots and the content that matters and is relevant that you have to pay attention to. Okay? So I'm sure that the theoretical part, for the most part, is going to be the easiest part for you, and this is the one that we're going to discuss the least. But please pay a lot of attention to the experimental setting. How many generations do you have in each one of the experiments that are described. What kind of MOI do you have in each one of the conditions that are described? Are there any other choices from the authors that maybe could have been done differently? How would that change the experiment? How would that change the expectation? What kind of predictions can you make? Are the results skewed one way or another, or not at all? How would you design the experiment correctly? Or how would you design the experiment better? Okay. So those are the kind of things that I would like to cover. There are two papers. One is a little bit different than the first one, although the same populations are used in both of them. Did they change anything from one paper to the other? Did that make things better or worse? Or did it make any difference? Okay? So my goal for this discussion is to give you the tools to be capable of judging papers from experimental groups. So you don't have to just believe whatever it is that they did and pick things on blind faith. And there's lots of wonderful work, very carefully done, and things that are meaningful, and that's great. But again, this is science. You don't believe anybody, you believe the data. Okay? Provided that the data were generated correctly. And you know, there's always the option that somebody's missing something, or there's something that we don't know about, that if we had known about, we would have done something different. Fine, all this is great, but again, with what we know now, let's try to figure out what else we can learn and what else we don't know enough, or we don't have enough in our data set to come to conclusions. Okay? Questions? All right. Coffee time.